Today we are going to discuss about coagulation aided sedimentation. See, the word itself, it says coagulation aided sedimentation, means coagulation is there and after that sedimentation, again that chapter comes after doing some process of that coagulation, again that sedimentation chapter comes. Therefore it is called as coagulation aided sedimentation. Then just we will go back. In screening, what we do, we will remove floated materials, floated particles, for example trees, bushes, leaves, debris, they we will remove in screening. And after that, which are escaped from the screens, smaller materials, but the specific gravity is more than the water, those are removed in sedimentation. Why? Because they have a specific gravity more than the water. If we retard the velocity, then definitely in due course of time, that time is called as a detention period, within that detention period, 4 to 8 hours, then those particles automatically, due to gravity, they will come and settle to the bottom. But still smaller particles will be there. Small particles means, even though you leave it for many hours, but they never settle. Best example is your colloidal particles. For example, milk is there. Milk is made up of white pigments will be there. They are called as colloidal particles. Your toothpaste is there. Inside the toothpaste, some white color will be there. But those particles are colloidal particles. And foam is there. When you use a soap and you will get a foam, that foam is again the colloidal particles. These particles, they never settle down. They never settle down. We need to forcibly make them to settle down. Therefore, we have this chapter, that is a coagulation. Understood? Such colloidal particles, they are harmful for the human health. They are also available in the water. Those particles we need to remove from the water. Understood? Now, we will understand the mechanism, how it operates. In brief, I am going to tell you that colloidal particles are negatively charged. They are negatively charged. Colloidal particle surface will be having a negatively charged signs, that is minus. Understood? And the surface charge on colloidal particles give them long-term stability. It will give them long-term stability. Therefore, they never settle down. And one colloidal particle and the other colloidal particle, they never attract each other. Why? Because both are negatively charged. Like that, number of colloidal particles which are there in the water, they all are negatively charged. Therefore, they never attract each other and their mass will never increase. Therefore, they never settle. Understood? Now, what we need to do? We need to destabilize these particles. Destabilize means what? We need to build one surface layer on the colloidal particle. Colloidal particle is there, negatively charged is there. We need to make one surface on the colloidal particles. When we make colloidal particle, that thin surface, we will call it as a rigid or stern layer. Understood? Now, that rigid and stern layer, when it attached to that colloidal particle, then there will be a drop in the potentiality. That drop in the potentiality is called as stern potential. Then after that, another layer which will come and attack to that stern layer because of added water, then that layer is called as diffuse layer. In that diffuse layer, again the potentiality decreases. That potential is called as a zeta potential. Therefore, the complete particle, the colloidal particle, which has a much more potential, that is a negative charge, but because of this stern layer and this diffuse layer, that potentiality decreases. Now, the colloidal particle is surrounded by some gum-like structure. Gum-like layer is there. That layer will attract the smaller particle towards it. Understood? these smaller particles, and they come and stick to this colloidal particle, that is coagulated colloidal particle, and the mass of that becomes more, and that when that mass becomes more, that particle will come and settle by gravity. Understood? Once again I will explain. Colloidal particles are negatively charged. Many colloidal particles are there, they are all negatively charged, therefore they repel each other. We are adding some chemicals into the water. Those chemicals are called as the coagulants. When we add a coagulants to the water, those coagulants make one layer on the colloidal particle. Those layers are called as a rigid layer and a diffuse layer. These layers having a gum in nature, that is called as agglomeration, and this agglomeration which will destabilize the material, and this start attracting the small particles, small other colloidal particles and small soil particles, that will attract it towards this particle, colloidal particle. Then the weight will increase, therefore the size will increase, and that increased size with increased weight will settle down due to gravity. This is coagulation. Technically, here we have few terms. The first one is a coagulants. Coagulants are chemical compounds which are used for coagulation purpose. Next technical term is flocks. When we add a coagulants to the water, when we mix them thoroughly, then there a gelatinous precipitation appears. That gelatinous precipitation is called as a flock, and this process is called as flocculation. The entire process, adding the coagulant, mixing and preparing a flocculation, this entire process is called as coagulation. When coagulation completes, then again we will give some detention time there, but it is a very lesser than the sedimentation detention time. Then in that detention time, water is allowed into the sedimentation tank. Again it comes there. In the sedimentation tank, they all come and settle to the bottom and they are removed. Now, chemicals used for coagulation. There are four types of chemicals used in coagulation. The first one is alum, and the second one is copperas, and the third one is chlorinated copperas, and the fourth one is sodium aluminate. We will explain them in details. Now, the first one is use of alum as a coagulant. See, this is my favorite topic. Why? That I will explain when I come to the problems. Okay, no? Now look at here. The first one is use of alum as a coagulant. Then what is alum? Alum is also called as a filter alum also. But actually its chemical formula is Al2SO4+18H2O. See this reaction. Alum is mixed with 3 calcium bicarbonates and produces 3 calcium sulfate and 2 aluminium hydroxide precipitation and 6 carbon dioxide which evaporates. This is a balanced equation. You need to mug up this one. There is no alternate. You need to mug up that one. Look at here. Alum is mixed with 3 parts of calcium bicarbonate. Then where this calcium bicarbonate comes here? There will be water, no? To water we are adding alum. Then where will be this calcium bicarbonate? Calcium bicarbonate will be there in the water itself. Water, sometimes it is alkaline, and now the sedimentation and the coagulation, it is just a second part of this water treatment. Therefore, the water is raw only. Therefore, in the raw water itself, the calcium bicarbonate will be there. And the alum added, it will react with calcium bicarbonate present in the water itself. then it will produce calcium sulfate, aluminium hydroxide and carbon dioxide. The second question is, if the water doesn't have calcium bicarbonate, then what? If the water doesn't have calcium bicarbonate, then it might have calcium hydroxide. Then the reaction follows like this. Alum reacts with the 3 calcium hydroxide, then produces the same 3 calcium sulfate, aluminium hydroxide plus 18H2O. Then, the third question is, if that is also not present in the water, then it may contain sodium carbonate, Na2CO3. Then the reaction goes like this. Then alum, 3 parts of sodium carbonate, and that produces 3 parts of sodium sulfate and 2 Al2OH thrice, 3 CO2 and 15H2O. It will produce. Then again the question comes, fourth question. If this is also not there in the water, see, calcium bicarbonate, it must be there to happen this reaction. Calcium hydroxide alternate, it should be there. If that is not there, then sodium bicarbonate should be there. If that is also not there, then what to do? Then you need to add externally that content to the water. That is a calcium, that we will call it as a lime. We need to add lime to the water. We need to generate that calcium bicarbonate or calcium hydroxide inside the water so that this reaction happens. Means to happen this reaction, calcium bicarbonate or calcium hydroxide is a compulsory. It should be there in the water, or you need to add externally to the water. Understood? Now we will understand one more phenomenon which is discussed in the second module. That is your alkalinity. We'll go back and come here. Alkalinity is always because of 3 parameters: carbonates, bicarbonates and hydroxyl OH, HCO3 minus, CO2, CO3 minus minus and OH minus. Because of these 3 compounds, and these 3 will mix with some other compounds, and that will be, there will be alkalinity in the water. Okay. When we add alum to the water, then the water should be alkaline. Okay. Then alkaline, that too with calcium bicarbonate. Understood? Alkalinity due to bicarbonate, alkalinity due to carbonate, alkalinity due to hydroxyl. Out of these 3, alkalinity due to bicarbonate and alkalinity due to hydroxyl should be there in the water to happen this reaction. If it is not there, then you need to make that to happen. Okay. Now, when we will get, every time we cannot do experiment whether alkalinity is there or not. Okay. And checking this one every time, it is time consuming. Therefore, we have a scale here, that is a pH. Now look at here. We have a pH from 1 to 14. And alkalinity test, it says that if the water has a pH more than 10, then the alkalinity, that is also alkalinity, that alkalinity is due to OH. If the water's pH is from 10 to 8.5, then the alkalinity is due to OH alone or carbonate alone or OH and carbonate together. Understood? If the pH value is less than 8.5 and more than 4.5, then the alkalinity is due to bicarbonates only. Bicarbonates only. Bicarbonates, their H is there, no? Means it is coming towards acid side. Therefore, that H will come and add to that carbonate, and therefore that alkalinity is due to bicarbonate. Understood? Now, means to happen this alum reaction inside the water, then the pH of the water should be 8.5 to 4.5. If the pH value is less than 4.5, then you don't get any alkalinity.
even there is a carbon and oxygen hydrogen is there, but that forms carbonic acid, not alkalinity. Therefore, our pH value should be 8.5 to 4.5. Some textbooks say 8.3 to 4.5. Next is, to happen this coagulation process very quick and very effective, then your pH value should be 8.3 to 6.5 means we will have a 100% assurance that only bicarbonate present in this one, 6.5 to 8.3. Therefore, the pH should be maintained like that. Means here we can give one general statement that the coagulation alum will be very effective when the water is alkaline, when the water has a pH 6.5 to 8.3. Okay, now again we'll see the reaction. Alum is added with the three parts of calcium bicarbonate. Then what it gives? It gives three parts of calcium sulfate. Now see this calcium sulfate, can you recall something in second module? I will give a hint. In second module, come to the chemical properties, hardness. Yes, in hardness we have two types, temporary hardness, permanent hardness. Yes, permanent hardness, sulfate, calcium and magnesium of sulfate is there. Therefore, you can recall that one. You can see here, calcium sulfate means it is generated. Alum is added with the three parts of calcium bicarbonate and it gives three parts of calcium sulfate means permanent hardness is induced inside the water by adding alum, demerit. Next, it produces two parts of aluminium hydroxyl. Yes, hydroxide precipitation. Aluminium hydroxide precipitation is the precipitation which is exactly required for us. That is called as a flock. And that starts attracting your small particles and that size increases and there that particle size increases and that settlement happens. Therefore, the reaction whatever we are adding alum here to produce, our main intention is 2AlOH thrice, aluminium hydroxide precipitation. This is a very important parameter for us. Then after getting this one, this will be flocculates, this will is a precipitation, and after that we will get 6 parts of carbon dioxide. Now again go to the second module, chemical properties, dissolved gases, CO2. In there, CO2, when it is there in the water, then there will be a corrosion in the pipes. This is some demerit. Means by adding alum, sedimentation process becomes effective. We can remove many particles, but the demerit is permanent hardness increases and corrosion problem arises because of 6CO2, but of course it will evaporate, but still the water will be having some CO2. This is somewhat dangerous with respect to alum, but alum is very good product and cheaper in market. The cost is very cheap compared to other, understood? Therefore we are preferring alum. And if the water is somewhat very clear, then the dosage you can use 5 mg per liter. If it is very turbid water, then 85 mg per liter, maximum 85 mg per liter you can use as a dosage. Understood? But in an average, 17 mg per liter is used for coagulation purpose. Okay, means the dosage is depending on what? Dosage depending on the turbidity of the water, concentration of suspended particles. Okay, now this we will identify in the laboratory. There is one column test is there. In that test we will do this one and we will identify how much dosage is required. Understood? Okay, now how to use this equation practically I will explain later. Next, second chemical coagulant is copperas. Copperas means it is a ferrous sulfate. Chemical name is FeSO47H2O. Okay, now the reaction is like this. Copperas reacts with hydrated lime, CaOH twice, and it produces calcium sulfate, then ferrous hydroxide and 7H2O. Okay, now this is one reaction. If the water has a CaOH twice inside, then this reaction will happen. If the water doesn't have a CaOH twice, if the water has a calcium bicarbonate, then this reaction will happen. That is ferrous sulfate, calcium bicarbonate, then it produces FeHCO3 twice, CaSO4 plus 7H2O. Now, this FeHCO3 twice again reacts with CaOH twice. Then it produces FeOH twice, 2CaCO3 plus 2H2O. Now here in the first equation and second equation, in the first equation one reaction took place and we got ferrous hydroxide. And in the second reaction, two reactions took place and there we got in the last reaction ferrous hydroxide. Either that reaction or this reaction, this ferrous hydroxide again reacts with O2 and H2O and it produces ferric hydroxide precipitation. Now, our aim here is ferric hydroxide precipitation. This is a very important compound for us. This will act as a flock here. Understood? Now, based on the availability of CaOH twice and HCO3 twice, the reaction two reaction happened, but ultimate aim is ferric hydroxide, FeOH thrice. Understood? Then again, by adding copperas, again the permanent hardness induces. Okay, but that CO2 problem is not there here. Now, chlorinated copperas as a coagulant. Then, what is chlorinated copperas? Okay, we will not get that one. To get that one, what we need to do? Copperas, the earlier agent. That copperas is mixed with three parts of chlorine. Then it will give ferric sulfate and ferric chloride. This ferric sulfate and ferric chloride together it is called as chlorinated copperas. And out of these two, one react with the hydrated lime and it produces ferric hydroxide precipitation. That was required for us. And the other one again reacts with hydrated lime and it again gives ferric hydroxide precipitation. Again, it was required for us. Okay. Likewise, we are getting flock here, FeOH thrice. Ferric sulfate is quite effective in 4 to 7 and above 9, and whereas ferric chloride is effective when pH is 3.5 to 6.5 and above 8.5. The combination has therefore proved to be very effective coagulant for treating low pH water. Understood? Now, very interesting fourth coagulant, that is sodium aluminate. And the sodium aluminate, the chemical formula is Na2Al2O4. This sodium aluminate reacts with calcium bicarbonate and produces calcium aluminate, CaAl2O4 and Na2CO3CO3H2O. Then it can again, that sodium aluminate again it can react with CaCl2 and it can produce CaAl2OH4 and 2NaCl. Then again, if that is not there, then sodium aluminate can react with calcium sulfate and it can produce CaAl2O4. Here, calcium aluminate, CaAl2O4, is our flock. It is used for sedimentation. It helps in sedimentation. Now, very interesting thing here is, if the water has alkalinity of bicarbonate, then sodium aluminate will react with that and it will produce its compounds, that flock. And if alkalinity is not there, then only it will act as a coagulant, means it is a some positive thing compared to alum. Alum is only when it is alkaline, then only that reaction takes place. But here alkalinity is not there, then also aluminium sodium aluminate can react and produce flock. Now, one more advantage here is, if any permanent hardness like CaSO4, then it will react with the permanent hardness and it will produce a flock, as well as decreases the permanent and temporary hardness. Therefore, sodium aluminate is a somewhat very good coagulant. The positive compared to alum is, it doesn't require alkalinity and it reduces permanent and temporary hardnesses. But the disadvantage is, this is 1.5 times, means 50% more costlier than alum. Therefore, we avoid this sodium aluminate. Then where we can use this one is, where a boiler feed water, if you want to treat, there you can use, because the corrosion or incrustation in the boiler is avoided due to hardness or due to increase in the CO2. If we want to reduce that effect, then you can use sodium aluminate as a coagulant. Okay, some advanced treatment plant you can use sodium aluminate, otherwise alum is good for us and universally accepted. Then the comparison of alum and iron salts you need to do. The general here is, alum is used for water treatment and iron salts are used for sewage treatment, and rest other some 3 to 4 points you do it by your own. Thank you. Today this much is enough.